Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome. My name is Tony Penny, and I'm the director of the Walter and Lenore Annenberg Presidential Learning Center here at the Ronald Reagan Presidential Foundation. In honor of our men and women in uniform, I ask that you please rise and we begin our program with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation, under God, indivisible,
very much. So thank you all for joining us this evening to learn about one of our favorite subjects here and from one of our favorite scholars. Before I formally introduce our special guest speaker this evening, I want to first thank our friends at the Ashbrook Center, with whom we've greatly enjoyed partnering over the years. And I also want to thank the generous sponsor who's made this evening and our reception tonight possible, a longtime friend and supporter of the Reagan Foundation, the lovely and talented Miss Norma Zimdahl. So thank you very much. And here to give us a more formal introduction to Miss Zimdahl is the Director of Programs for the Ashbrook Center, Mr. Jason Ross.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here. This is a wonderful crowd. I'm delighted that you're all here. Again, I'm Jason Ross. I'm Director of Programs with the Ashbrook Center at Ashland University. The Ashbrook Center is an independent nonprofit educational center. Our mission is to bring teachers, students, and citizens into the conversation about what it means to be American. Ashbrook was founded in 1983. Our dedicatory address was given by none other than President Ronald Reagan. So we are always very proud and very privileged to be able to partner with the Reagan Library. And I want to say a special thanks to Tony Penny and Janet Tran for their assistance in this event and their partnership in many other joint programs, past and future. I also want to thank and welcome this evening's sponsor, Ms. Norma Zimdahl. For those of you who have the good fortune of knowing Norma, you know that she is a born entertainer. She had an extensive career on stage and screen, performing with such legends as Sid Caesar and Arthur Godfrey. She continues to perform, and recently she performed a piano recital here in this building, out in the atrium where Air Force One is located, which is a grand space for what I'm sure was a grand event. Her talent as a performer is only part of her spirit and soul as an entertainer, and I'm grateful to her, and we are all grateful to her for entertaining us here tonight by bringing us together for this event. Norma, I want to thank you once again for your sponsorship and support of this event, and I'd like to ask you to come forward and give the invocation.
Thank you very much, Jason. You're very kind. Please bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, as we gather here tonight for a wonderful lecture in celebration of our Constitution, we bring you great praise and we rejoice in your love for us. How grateful we are to enjoy all the blessings you give us every day and allow us to live in this jewel of a country, America the Beautiful. We pray that you give us the need to have a sense of purpose, the need to care for our minds and bodies, and to create meaningful human relationships that make life valuable and to live a good life so we can go back to the principles that made our beautiful country so great. Individual rights, free markets, personal initiatives, and self-responsibility. Please, God, teach us the art of staying in focus and not to be detached from reality, so we can remain free and true to the hopes and dreams of our founding fathers. We pray, dear Lord, that you stay at the very center of our lives, because we know the closer we are to you, the clearer we hear the music of your spirit. We pray for peace in a troubled world and for our great country, the United States of America. Amen.
Thank you very much for that beautiful invocation. At the end of the Constitutional Convention, at the end of a long, sweltering summer of 1787, kind of like our own long, sweltering summer, Ben Franklin, who at 81 was both the oldest and arguably the most famous, although General Washington might disagree, delegate in attendance, emerged from what would eventually become known as Independence Hall and was asked, famously, "Well, Doctor, what have we got, a republic or a monarchy?" And his reply was, "A republic if you can keep it." Well, tonight we have the honor of hearing from Dr. Gordon Lloyd. I'm not going to read all of his academic credentials. You have the program, which lists them extensively. But what I can tell you is that he has done as much as anyone to preserve the republic. As the author of three books on the American founding and the creator of the amazing content he'll share with you tonight on the website teachingamericanhistory.org, I think the only people who know more about the founding were those who were actually in attendance back in 1787. In 1983, President Reagan said, "We've always had a love affair with learning in this country. Education has been a mainspring for our democracy and freedom, a means of providing gifts of knowledge and opportunity to all citizens, no matter how humble their background, so they could climb higher, help build the American dream, and leave a better life for those who follow." We were wise enough to heed Thomas Jefferson's warning that any nation which expects to be ignorant and free expects what never was and never will be. Well, if we are to preserve the republic, we must know something about its origins, just as if you want a tree to thrive, you must water it at the roots. And if there's someone who knows a thing or two about the origins of this country, it's Dr. Gordon Lloyd. If it were up to me, he would teach every student in the country, and I know that he's on a mission to do that through his work post-retirement at Pepperdine, and inspire them with his passion for the founding. Tonight, those of us who are in the room, I think we're in for a real treat tonight. You're in for a real treat as you learn a little bit about Madison's Republic, so please join me in welcoming America's professor, Dr. Gordon Lloyd.
That's tough to live up to, but you mean it, otherwise you wouldn't say it. All right, we're going to talk about Madison's Republic. To me, what comes to mind is a possible alternative. That would be Plato's Republic. Although Plato was Greek, the word republic comes from the Latin. And it essentially means the best regime, and res publica means the public good, the public things. And in an imaginary conversation, which really doesn't matter whether it actually took place or not, Socrates and a bunch of younger people, Socrates always hung out with the young because he thought they were capable of learning and being corrupted. And that they talked about if it were possible, what would the best regime in the entire world look like? And that was a conversation which, as I say, may or may not have taken place. But Plato took down notes and worked on them for a long, long time. They decided, Socrates and Glaucon and Adeimantus, that the best regime was one that had no faction, that they had to end those sorts of things that made people kill each other. And so they talked about what kinds of things make people kill each other. And then the answer is, do away with them. If you do away with them, then the regime will be A, perfect, and last forever. And it requires, in a certain sense, wisdom. And the wisdom which Socrates seems to suggest is metaphysical wisdom, not practical wisdom, but some kind of notion of the good or the idea of the good to get this, to grasp what the best regime is, never mind what it takes to put into practice or to keep. And lo and behold, the folks there at this gathering, with the help of Socrates, come up with the conclusion that unless a philosopher becomes a king, then there is no hope for the rest of the world. Of course, the philosopher that Socrates had in mind was himself. In real life, Socrates was killed. In this imaginary conversation, he becomes king. But the interesting thing is that there are sort of three classes. There's no private property. There's no private family. There's no right of conscience. There's no dissent. And most importantly, there's no consent. That is a lot of force, and the question becomes, how do you put this into practice? And the idea is, well, you get rid of most of the people who are in existence. You send them away. So we start all over again. And, well, isn't that an impossibility? Well, you wanted the best, didn't you? This is how you do it. Well, lo and behold, what happens is that the best doesn't last very long. It doesn't even last the night. Because what happens is that difficulties start. That is, faction reemerges. And one thing leads to another. So that wisdom is not used for pure ideas. It is used how to get ahead. And then it is used for making money. Or it is used for becoming a lawyer. Or it is used for becoming a lawyer. Or it is used for something else. So the purity of the regime gets modified because of human nature. And it collapses. And that is the story. That's the end of the story of what started as a wonderful project. Now, what we're going to go through with Madison's Republic is slightly different. It wasn't imaginary. It was real. It wasn't just five people in the room probably getting sloshed over during the evening, but rather it was 55 people over 88 days who might have got sloshed at the end. But they had a good, real conversation among real people. Madison does not become king. In fact, there is no monarchy. And the kind of wisdom that Madison suggests is practical wisdom or prudence. And what makes this whole enterprise legitimate is not this metaphysical wisdom and the grasping of the good, and then it has to be imposed because it is good, but rather some form of consent. That is, consent makes things legitimate. So if you've got 55 people from a whole bunch of different backgrounds and you put them together, they're going to disagree with each other. So it's going to be almost impossible to get rid of faction. So you're going to have to manage faction. You're going to have to deal with faction. Why does faction take place in the first place? The answer is because of liberty. Oh, so Plato would be willing to get rid of liberty in order to have the good? The answer is yes. So Madison wants liberty. Yes. That means we're going to have some kind of faction. The answer is yes. The question is, can we control it? Let's see. What does that require? Some notion of toleration, some notion of compromise, learning when to compromise, learning when not to hold on to ideas. And what I want to do tonight is to show you the huge difference between Madison's Republic and Plato's Republic. That Madison's Republic is a more perfect union. It's more perfect than whatever happened before. It is, in fact, the very first time that 55 people sat down and worked this out without a drop of blood being spilled. Before that, you had an imaginary republic from Plato. You had maybe Nero. You had Theseus. You had one person. It's very easy to be a founder when it's only you. All right, off with your head, out of the city. The great difficulty of founding is how do you found with multiple founders? And so Madison is not only a participant, he is a recorder. And he records this debate that takes place over 88 days. He's not a court reporter, so not every word is recorded. You don't need to. Shakespeare was a great poet, a great writer. But you and I know that the life of Richard II didn't take place in 2 hours. And yet Shakespeare was able to portray that in 2 hours. You could sit down and read it. So the point is not that you need to know every single word, but you need guideposts and guidelines. So what we're going to do tonight, with the help of Jason, is I'm going to go through one of the websites. Jason is behind. He is the, we're in Plato's cave, Madison's cave, and he is the person, the puppeteer holding all the puppets, right? And here we, all we're seeing is life on the screen. One of these days we'll turn around and recognize it's all Jason pulling strings on us. There he goes. All right. So I have, with the help of the Ashbrook Center and with the encouragement of the Reagan folks, I have put together four websites that covers the entirety of what we might call Madison's Republic. Madison's Republic in terms of its creation. This is what we're going to spend time on today, tonight. The Constitutional Convention. The real convention. Not just an imaginary evening out with a, having a chat. The second website deals with Madison's explanation through the Federalist Papers. Now, often the Federalist Papers have been put on a status which is must reading, great classics, etc., and we do read some of it. And if we read any of the Federalist Papers, it's probably what Madison has written. And then the third stage is the actual ratification. Again, never before in the history of the world have people been faced with the issue of what are we going to do? Given the choice of saying yes or no, and making proposals to modify. The beauty of America is the dynamic of the conversation. Under Plato's Republic, there's a conversation, but you know what the end product is going to be. It's to discover the good. The Madison conversation is unrehearsed. You don't know what the end product's going to be. That's why consensus or agreement or modification, that's what it is. It's the conversation which really matters. But conversation that leads to action. And you have to, what happens if you win? You have to be magnanimous. What happens if you lose? You have to be magnanimous. Otherwise, the system isn't going to work. You've got the creation, which is what we're going to look at. The explanation, which is the Federalist Papers and the pamphlet exchange. You've got the ratification, which happened indoors through from one state to another. And then you have the completion, which is the Bill of Rights. And Madison is there at every one of those four events and records every one of those four events. So to tell the entire story of Madison's Republic would require us to go through all four. But we don't have that time. So I'm choosing one, the creation story. Before I begin, let me remind you of this very, very sobering fact. No regime in the history of the world has lasted forever. Why? Faction. What do we do about it? Do we eliminate it or do we control it? Madison's answer is we control it. So there's still going to be problems, but the issue is, can we live with it, and how do we live with it? All right, let's take a look then at the at this one website. If we take a look at this website, there's an introduction which we won't bother with. You can read it. It indicates, in fact, how the delegates were chosen. Each state had the opportunity to choose between 2 and 7 delegates, and as an honorary message, Pennsylvania chose Ben Franklin as number 8. It was up to each state legislature to choose these delegates. Who authorized them to do this? Now, if you don't particularly care for America, which there are unfortunately a whole bunch of scholars who are inclined not to particularly care for America, that you will emphasize the fact that the meeting was a coup d'etat, was held in secret, and was in fact illegal. If you are really in tune with America, you will realize that you don't have to wait for somebody in office to tell you what to do. There's something called a grassroots movement that you can get together in order to hold to hold a convention. After all, it's the right of the people to choose the form of government under which they live. So there are really two authorizations that are going on. And I explained in the introduction. Authorization number one is the Declaration of Independence, the Annapolis Convention, the right of Americans to get together to chat about improving their situation. And six states do that with the lead of Virginia. The other authorization is much more legalistic and shall we say, practical. We don't want to move ahead until the existing government, which we're about to modify, gives the okay that it's okay for us to meet. And finally, the Congress does give that authorization, and a very, very narrow authorization it is. Six states follow that. So immediately you have a conversation which is going to occur at the convention concerning the authority for what we're doing, which is a very good American conversation, by the way. The rule of law, the rule of specific law versus the rule of higher law, how far do you go, et cetera. That's 12. Rhode Island never showed up. So that's what the introduction essentially does. Set up the authorization, the convention. If we take a look at this, what I have tried to do is to make the convention readable and accessible without dumbing it down. Thus, I've tried to present the convention as a four-act drama. And if we click on the four-act drama, we'll see that Act One presents the alternative plan. So people came there with alternative ideas concerning what the problem was. Some delegates, interestingly, the older ones, thought that all that needed to be changed was to give Congress a few more powers, like power over interstate commerce and power over taxation, and let's go home. We don't have a systemic structural problem. We just have a powers problem. People like Madison and Washington thought we had a systemic problem. We need to fundamentally alter the institutional framework in order to protect liberty. That meant we wanted to move toward a separation of powers. We wanted to move towards bicameralism. We wanted to move much more clearly to what was to be done at the national level and what was to be done at the state level. We needed to completely reconsider. Why? Because the Articles of Confederation under which we lived was really, according to Madison, a wartime document. And Washington argued that America was only America because of the war. Now we need to, good to see you. That America is America only because of the war, but is it possible to be an American and still be at peace? And is an opportunity that could be lost and lost forever. So you've got a younger generation, say, like Madison, who's more willing to get to the root of the problem. And then the older generation who are less willing to do that, but much more willing to alter the powers. So you've got these alternative plans, and immediately you have a conversation. And what is the conversation? Are we doing the legal thing? Are we doing the right thing? Randolph says, what do I scruple about a certain legality with the future of the republic is at stake? Another more prudent gentleman said, but why are we spending all this time trying to create this republic which the world has never seen before? If it's only going to be rejected. And James Wilson, if I may bring him up to date, said, we have no idea what the people are going to say. We haven't had a focus group. We really don't know. Our job is to create the best that we can, given the material which we have. We're not starting from scratch, although we would love to start from scratch. We cannot start from scratch. So let's go as far as we can and see what we come up with. Well, there's a nice little story, but it's not true, but it's still a nice little story. And I like it, so I'm going to tell you it. You've got Madison with the Virginia plan, which sort of is a radical departure from the Articles of Confederation.
two branches, separation of powers, etc. Congress has control over a lot of things. And then you have the New Jersey plan, which says only change a few powers. And at that stage, according to the story, the New Jersey plan looks like the middle ground between the Articles and the Virginia plan. So what we need is to make the Virginia plan look moderate, because Americans love the middle ground. So along comes Hamilton, and he presents a plan that is way over here. And the idea is that makes the Virginia plan look incredibly moderate. Thank you, Alex. Only you could do that. And that's a great story, but it ain't true. Because no one changed their mind. No one changed their vote. Hamilton's June the 18th speech is extremely important after the delegates settle the representation question of people and states. My impression of Hamilton is he finds that boring. He finds that playing in the sandbox. When you guys get rid of that question, give me a call. And Hamilton leaves pretty soon thereafter. And only returns when he gets word that it's serious. That's Act One. Madison survives, but he's a bit bruised. But he reports all the bruising. So there's a difference between Plato's Republic and Madison's Republic. Plato never gets bruised. I mean, Socrates never gets bruised. Madison gets bruised. And Madison, the recorder, shows the bruises. And I think that's extremely important because it captures the nature of conversation that's going on. You're not going to win all the time. What do you do when you win? What do you do when you lose? Some people there, and a lot of places, they leave in a huff. Well, you could be so principled that you leave in a huff and I don't want anything to do with it. Fine. You can hang in there and see what else happens down the line. All right, the curtain rises on Act Two, and you think, well, now they're going to really get at it and fill in all the details, but it doesn't happen. The folks who lost with the New Jersey plan dig in, illegal, won't fly, et cetera, et cetera. And this is the hardest part of the convention to read, because it doesn't seem that anything is being advanced. But I invite you to think about management-labor relations. I invite you to think about all kinds of negotiations that take place with faculty and administrators, waiting for a breakthrough to occur, and a breakthrough never occurs, or it only occurs later, and you can't predict. And so we reach the end of June, and no advancing has occurred, and people are well, if you're the reader, you're going to say, come on, get me? No, but you have to suffer. You have to be able to, I think, to understand that not everything works smoothly in a consent of the governed democracy. Not everybody is a socrat. In fact, Madison said, in Federalist, if all Athenians were Socrates, it would still be a mob. So that it doesn't require that kind of wisdom. It requires a different kind of dynamic to get through. And you have to be able to get through times when there is no breakthrough. And then right at the end, a breakthrough, in the end of June, a breakthrough occurs. Up till then, it was either government by the people or government by the states. And a breakthrough happens. Well, why don't we be government by the people for some things and government by the states for others, partly national, partly federal? And people say, you know what? That's thinking outside the box. Let's do it. So that kind of entrepreneurial thinking, I think, is necessary in a country which is committed to consent of the governed, and not all the governed are going to be well-intentioned or well-meaning. And Tony mentioned that the problem with democracy, or even democratic government, was the issue of that the folks may be poor and stupid. I mean, that was the original understanding of democracy. Many are poor and stupid. In one sense, you cannot have a democracy that works if the many are poor and stupid. Therefore, civic education to solve some kind. You don't require a PhD. That's not what I'm saying. You have to understand, for example, that not every single regime has failed. What is it that makes things work? What does it require in your character as a citizen to try to make things work? And as far as poverty is concerned, it is quite clear, as far as I'm concerned, that Madison wanted to put us in along the road to a commercial kind of republic, which encouraged private property, free enterprise, et cetera, properly understood. And this is thinking, again, outside the box, partly national, partly federal. So a committee was created, all right? So they're talking a lot, and then we have to do something. So you can't get everything done by simply a huge committee. So what do? You create a smaller group of people, and interestingly, if you look at who gets on that committee, who is selected by the committee, it shows that the tone of the convention at that moment was, we have to get out of this mess. And the committee comes up with a proposal, which is known as the Connecticut Compromise, which is the first branch. By the way, historians tend to describe the House as the lower branch and the Senate as the upper branch. And I think that's a huge mistake, that the framers themselves referred to the House as the first branch and the Senate as the second branch, not in terms of British class structure or even the feudalistic structure or the monarchical structure, but in terms of the, so one of the challenges facing the framers is, if you've rejected aristocracy, you've rejected monarchy, why do you want a strong executive? And why do you want two branches? And that's a very, very interesting conversation to go through. Because if you don't want monarchy, why do you want a strong executive? If you don't want aristocracy, why do you want a second branch? What are these branches supposed to do? And that is an American contribution to this discussion. Well, the compromise occurs, and they decide it's time now to produce a draft. So they have an intermission. Lloyd, you're going too far. I know that you want to make it a drama. I know you want to do all of this. But really, the answer is yes. An intermission takes place. And five people are chosen. One from Pennsylvania, makes a lot of sense. One from Massachusetts, one from Virginia. Those are the three most populous states. And it makes up about 45% of the population. So if you want consent of the governed, a representative from each of those three large states has got to be there to be able to say, let's not deviate from consent of the governed. A member from Connecticut is there. Why? To make sure that the arrangement, it seems to me, about partly national, partly federal, is maintained. And then one more with five. Why? Because, well, you got to break a tie if you want. But also, what else is going on that needs to be addressed? We've talked about representation of people needs to be addressed, representation of states need to be addressed. There's an outlying problem that starts to that emerges in Act One and in Act Two, and it is South Carolina, that introduces the notion that wealth is power, and that over the centuries, all the way back to ancient times, wealth has been represented, whether it's in a House of Lords or in a mixed regime of Aristotle. Wealth, as wealth, has been represented. And our peculiar wealth is slavery. So that adds a dimension to the discussion, which becomes very problematic, how you deal with this. Now, once you reach William Lloyd Garrison and 20th century historians, the fact that some compromise was made with slavery indicates not only was America illegally founded, but is ill-founded. And so coming to grips with where the slavery question comes in and how the framers gripped with it and what they did becomes critical. And it becomes critical today, as much as it became critical in the 1860s and the 1850s. And for me, the issue is the Dred Scott case and Lincoln's position, which is the framers put slavery in the cause of ultimate extinction, and Taney's argument that the framers never would have intended all men are created equal to include blacks. That is the issue. Fascinating for me is that neither Lincoln nor Taney read these debates. Or if they read the debates, they don't cite them at all. And so for me, Madison's Republic, a republic if you can keep it, turns on a question that is Lincoln correct or is Taney correct? And the answer, I would argue, if you pay attention to the way in which the debates unfold, you look at the votes, you look at the arguments, you look at this, that, and the other, I would say Lincoln is correct. But why did Lincoln not go to the convention? I mean, go to the convention records. I can only speculate. And the speculation is twofold. One, somehow, and this is pure speculation, that William Lloyd Garrison had become very powerful in the abolitionist movement and said that the debates, Madison's debate, showed that the framers made a pact with the devil. So that in some way, reciting the founding, these debates, wouldn't help the argument. The other is the Northwest, the status of the Northwest Ordinance, where, and Lincoln kept arguing about slavery in the territories could be under the control of Congress. The Committee on Detail report comes out with the first draft. I could go on, but I think I've given you a flavor of it. Five people are on that committee. The end is in sight, the Brearley Committee. The one thing that the delegates have not been able to deal with is the election of the president. First of all, shall we have one president or two? Well, I can't answer that until I know whether the president is reelectable or not. Well, I don't know that unless I know whether the president can be impeached. I can't answer that unless I know how much power the president has. Well, I can't answer that unless I know whether there's one or two presidents. And so this is a leftover, which is given to the Brearley Committee, which is also known as the Leftovers Committee. And this committee's job was to settle that issue. And how did they settle it? The Electoral College, which has been full of strange interpretations over the years, which we could get into if you want to. But it's a very, very American answer to a difficult question. And it's a mixture of, it's going, when you vote, you don't vote, you're not electing a president of America, you're electing a president of the United States. And your vote doesn't cross state lines. So there's a very interesting way of looking at it. This is very American. It doesn't seem very rational. It doesn't seem very uniform. It doesn't seem abstractly clear. It's a bit messy. That's right. It's a bit messy. All right. Let me turn with Jason's help to the map of Philadelphia. I'm claiming that a historic event took place. Madison Republic is real. A republic, if you can keep it, means you have to be able to control the violence of faction. You have to have consent of the governed, which means you're going to deal with messy people in a messy way, and it's not going to be pretty all the time. But liberty is going to be secure. So a historic event took place. But it also, this event took place in an actual place, Philadelphia. And if you want to, you can explore this at length. But so, for example, if you want to know what this place is, you put it on and it tells you the Indian Queen Tavern. And that's the place where the delegates would meet after hours. They met 6 days a week, 5 hours a day, and had early dinners, and then they caucused at night. And we don't know what went on, although you can have some guesses for what happened the next day. If we click on the Indian Queen Tavern, nothing comes up. Indian Queen Tavern. All right, that's what the Indian Queen Tavern used to look like. And there's a whole story in the Indian Queen Tavern. You can really get into the life of the framers and where they met and who stayed there and what was going on. So I decided, well, how have we remembered this place? And the answer is, if we go, it's disappeared. I mean, this is really interesting. I mean, it's like the Wizard of Oz. Right, if we scroll down, you'll see what it looks like today. It's there, it's Fox News. Which is like the Indian Tavern, Queen Tavern, I guess. So how have we remembered it? We haven't. And that raises a very interesting question of a republic, if you can keep it, is to what extent is keeping something, not only trying to encourage people to be middle class rather than poor, to become educated rather than stupid, but how do you keep memories alive? Which do you let go? I'll give you an example that my father put together over 200 jazz tapes in his retirement. Absolutely gorgeous jazz tapes, which I brought over from Britain when he died, and it's all, and I mean, I've still got them. I've said to my son, you can have them. He says, why would I want to have them? I can download them for 99 cents. And he's a left winger. So I say, well, because it's my father. So, well, that was just he's musing around in old, his old time. Well, wait till you get to be that age. So the question is, what do we remember? How do we remember it? And what don't we remember? If we go back now to historic Philadelphia, and we go to this one right here. You anticipated it, Jason. Very good. That's Mrs. House's boarding house. And Mrs. House was a Virginian, and she ran this boarding house, high class, and the Virginia delegations stayed there. And so during the 88 days, Madison lived there, worked on his notes, worked on the Virginia plan, etc. All right, incredible. We have this debates out of it, which I would rank up there with Plato's Republic. In fact, I think it's even stronger than the Federalist, because, and I'll tell you why. The Federalist tends to be one-sided. Madison's debates captures the whole dynamic of American life with this side and that side, and people getting ticked off and this, that, and the other. The whole messy stuff of politics. Well, Mrs. House's boarding house. I started collecting this back in the 1970s, 1980s. In the 1970s, 1980s, Mrs. House's boarding house where Madison stayed was a gentleman's toilet. And then, as we go down, you can see there, James Madison, delegate to the state here. That's all the memory we have of James Madison staying there. And then around about 2000, without acknowledgement to Madison at all, that he was an important contributor to the Bill of Rights, we get a concrete slab where anybody, any idiot, can stand up and say whatever the heck they want to, as if that's democracy now rather than deliberation. It is dissent. And I said, First Amendment, that's what democracy is all about. Of course, Madison's Republic is both deliberative and the First Amendment. He did both. And he's in tune with himself, to use a Platonic approach. So what is Mrs. House's boarding house today? Here we go, keep going down. And one more, there you have it. It's public transport, elevated to Frankfurt line. But I guess that's progress. But I just heard, wow. That's the whole point. A republic, if you can keep it, means managing to keep alive a certain heritage of what is important and what is not important. I could spend easily 2 hours showing you, is there anything which we have kept alive? Well, yeah, Independence Hall. The cobblestone streets around there, we've kept alive. If we go and go back to the map, and we go right here, that's the scene of Gouverneur Morris's accident. That's Gouverneur Morris lost his leg in an accident, and there are all kinds of stories about it. But Gouverneur Morris apparently was in a carriage with a married woman, and an irate husband ran after the carriage, and Gouverneur Morris jumped out, and the wheel went over his leg. I see the peg leg there, right here. And I have, with the help of some of the historians at Independence Hall, managed to locate that this is the exact spot where he lost his leg. I remember it. I've even offered the city of Philadelphia a $500 check to put a little memento in the thing there. This is where he lost his leg. The crowd will be immense to see Morris. But no, the cobblestone streets remember, but Morris, where he lost his leg, hasn't been remembered. But there's a whole story about that. Perhaps the best place that's been kept is the city, other than Independence Hall, the City Tavern. And City Tavern, right here, that's it. Jason knows his map, that's it, City Tavern. And if we were to take a look at the City Tavern, as much as I'm enjoying this, I think I'm going to move on because time is running short. That's what the City Tavern used to look like. This is what the City Tavern looks like today. Very, very close indeed. So that we have remembered some things well, we've remembered some things not at all. We've remembered some things badly. So I think a republic, if you can keep it, is what are the memories and what are the stories we tell. I have never known another country like America that has such self-doubt or wants the country to be deemed to be ill-founded. Some of my best teachers had to say that, well, it's not Sparta. I would say, you go live in Sparta. Right? I like liberty. It's not give me liberty or give me Sparta because I repeat myself. Just as virtually as going to death. I have 5 more minutes, right?
Sure.
I mean, I could go on all night, but why? Let me just do. Yes, ma'am. Oh, you're embarrassed. No, you're not. No, you're not.
I listen to you all night.
No, you'll drop asleep. All right. I'm just warming up. We have a sort of a mutual friend in common, and she came from ISI and went to Pepperdine and came back and told you that I did a 4-hour class,
yes,
without a break.
Yes. No bathroom break,
no weak bladders, straight 4 hours. So I'm just warming up. But I'll show mercy on you. Okay. All right. Let me end with two points. Jason, let's go to the attendance record. Close this. And I think it's under resources. Yeah, convention attendance record. Okay, this took me up 20 years or so. to do. And what I've done is put together all the four acts, et cetera, with a summary of each day. And this tells you who was there at that time, on that day. So you can do an interchange if you really get very interested in wanting a full and complete understanding of who was there and who wasn't there. I have this also in Excel form. If we just show the Excel version, which would be on the main. Again, we go back to resources and attendance record. That's right. Attendance record is also available in Excel form. So instead of looking at a date, we just click that on. Yes, that's it. Thank you. What this does is if you go up there where it says 5th of June on the J, but scroll back, or maybe you have to scroll down here, scroll back to the 3rd. So what you have on top of each day, and this gives you the whole delegates, and it tells you whether they're there or not. And what that can do is to help you avoid some very great pitfalls. And it also, like, for example, why didn't Hamilton speak up on slavery? Because he wasn't there. What did Hamilton think about the changing of the phraseology from Congress to make war to declare war? He wasn't there. So it helps to avoid some issues like that. It also helps you to see that the only delegation in which every single member was there every single day was South Carolina. And it raises the question of the sheer impact that South Carolina could have by simply being there all the time with every delegate. It also shows you that Virginia sent seven delegates. Two left early because his wife was ill, and Dr. McClurg, because his wife said, you have patients at home who need you. So that left five. By the time August came along, Governor Randolph and George Mason started to side with each other against how the plan was going. Madison and Blair sided with each other to keep the plan going. For Virginia to vote, another person had to vote. And that person would be George Washington. And we've wondered all through these years about what is the role of Washington at the convention. Forrest McDonald says he didn't say anything because it was way above his head. Others have said, this is the position I hold, is that he didn't say anything because he knew he was going to die. And self-government can only exist if people can work it out without having a Nero or a Caesar or Washington to solve the problem. But Washington played a huge role, if you look at the voting, in August and September. And it's not just behind the scenes prodding, it is actually in the voting record. So it depends on how deep you want to go on this. This is America's story. And there's a whole, and I haven't even covered ratification or explanation or Bill of Rights. And I haven't even covered I've covered less than half. But I've given you a visual introduction. I've given you a textual introduction. I've given you like a historic introduction. And to conclude, we have to conclude with the signing. And if we go to the signing of the Constitution, say by Christie, we'll go back to the main page, and it would be the paintings, I think. Oh, no, interactive map, that's it. Well, I don't know why they have that under the, use the interactive, correct. So what this does is to show you the delegates. There are 39 there. Now, this painting hangs in the Capitol building. And Washington is there. We could go through a whole bunch of things. But very interesting, I'm wondering, there's Hamilton, there's Franklin. And you don't even have to know your friends and students don't have to know who these people are. They can just look, they can just take the browser, go over it, and it tells you, there's Roger Sherman looking dour, pieces of paper on the floor. I'm frustrated. I didn't... It's very difficult to interpret an interpretation, but that's my interpretation. So you could ask your friends and students, if you're an artist, how would, and you read the debates, how would you portray the Connecticut delegation? As losers, as frustrated, or did they not, in fact, come out very well? Why would you choose to put front and center Hamilton, who was there only quarter of the time, whose real fame came after the convention, and Franklin, whose real fame became before the convention? This is an interpretation of an interpretation. But it's still a wonderful way of interpreting what makes, what in the artist's mind makes America great. And of course, you can't help but wonder what the heck Hamilton might be whispering to Franklin. I am not even going to speculate, other than to say, when we leave this building, what are you likely to say? A republic, if you can keep it, you bastard.
Right? Maybe he's rehearsing.
I have no idea.
Artistic license. The books are from Jefferson's library.
But it still makes for conversation, because these stories, these narratives are critical. It's like Grandpa in the war. It's like going fishing. You tell stories, you sit around the fireplace, and you tell stories about your country, you tell stories about your family. These are stories, these are narratives that need to be told and to be proud of, instead of a narrative that Columbus came here and killed everybody with disease. As if this is not one of the most important things that has ever happened in the history of the world. I remember, Mark, you and I having lunch, and you said that your daughter went to great, and but the way the teacher put it is, what's wrong with this painting? And to ask that question, what is wrong with that painting, is to approach that there's something ill-founded about America to start off with. Rather than celebrate, it is dumping from the very start. And I only invite you to think about what the teacher might have in mind to provoke students to think about it. Let us end. You've got your hanky on. All right, let us end not only with the signing here, but what did the framers do after they signed? By the way, at that meeting, what they're talking about is, well, I have some reservations. But as Franklin said, it's probably the best that we could do under the circumstances. What's wrong with that as a standard for living well? I would argue it's a darn good way to live, particularly if the alternative is prohibition, and that you have to kill everybody or impose your way on them in order for this grand scheme to come through. But with this, the entertainment of George Washington and City Tavern, as a younger person in the 1980s, I helped with the Miracle of Philadelphia exhibit. And I came across this. And silly, 15th of September, well, that's when the framers ended. That was a Saturday. And so maybe they just had their dinner there in 1770. And it was 55. So 55, part one for 55, somewhere in there, it says 55 people. And I thought, 55 gentlemen. I thought, oh man, I stumbled on the framers' menu. Final dinner menu. But then I realized it was the troops entertaining Washington. I dug deeper. I couldn't find the September the 17th menu. But I was told by people who claim they know what they're talking about that the menu wouldn't change that radically from Saturday to Monday. So let's go through the menu. Relishes and olives, 20 pounds. 54 bottles of Madeira, 20 pounds.
60 bottles of claret, 21 pounds, 8 bottles of old stock, 22 bottles of porter, 8 bottles of cider, 12 bottles of beer, 7 large bowls of punch. Students, do not spell like your friend. Cigars. Framers, you spell check, cigars, spermacities, candles, etc. Do decanters, wine glasses, and tumblers broken? Then we have 16 servants, 16 bottles of claret. Yeah, see, we're a democratic country. Yeah, this is not serfdom, right? This is 5 bottles of Madeira and 7 bowls of punch for 89 pounds. And as a student, in fact, I asked the student in 2011, what would it cost? And it's £9,693 in 2011. You translate that in US dollars, the meal was $15,000 in today's money, or 2011 money. And then I get some email. This generated incredible email. Can keep it. A guy called George Chrysler the 14th. Chrysler the 14th writes and says, what do you know about my grandfather? I said, nothing except what you're going to tell me. And he said, well, he was part of a group of folks. Yeah, I said, I know this. Said, look at them. Chrysler, Schultz, Turner, Kaiser, Harto, Rothi, Hartschrock, Brüder, Schwankenberg. What are all those Germans doing there? And he said to me, well, they were in Germantown. And my father, my grandmother had a pub, a tavern. And all of these folks were mercenaries for King George. And they were captured. And at the Treaty of Paris in 1783, they were given the possibility of repatriation to Germany. But they refused. I guess they liked American prison food. But here they are, 4 years later, playing at the farewell dinner of George Washington. Isn't that an incredible American immigrant story? May the blessings of liberty be with you.
I think we have enough time for a question or two if anyone wants one. And then we have copies of Professor Lloyd's book over here, if anybody wants to buy a copy and have it signed. But we'll start with, we have enough time for maybe a question or two. Does anybody have a question? Yes.
You mentioned only 2 branches of government. What of the judicial branch?
Oh, I deliberately omitted it. No, thank you. You're quite right to point that out. It is a peculiar American invention. You are quite right. I was deeply concerned with the idea of the House of Lords and the House of Commons, the class structure, and then the monarch. And I didn't focus on the judiciary. If I did focus on the judiciary, that would even add more, because the British did not have an independent judicial system. That would be a peculiarly American thing. So part of the American version of republic is a different understanding of 2 chambers, coming to reconcile with the fact you can have a strong, or you need a strong presidency without it becoming a monarch, and an independent judiciary that wouldn't go awry. And Brutus warns, Brutus being one of the anti-Federalists, warned, if you let the judiciary interpret the Constitution, we live under a Constitution, but the Constitution will be whatever the judiciary says it is. And Hamilton in Federalist 78, responding to Brutus, said, it'll never happen. And why will it never happen? Because the Congress will never let it happen. And if you want to talk about a republic, if you can keep it, it seems to me that Congress has virtually deferred to the judiciary and deferred to the presidency. And somehow, becoming a member of Congress is a stepping stone to becoming president. Look in the last 20, 30 years at the number of members of Congress who have run for president. And I'm not just talking, for example,
Biden, Obama, or president or the administrative state, Hillary Clinton. Now we could go on. Cruz, Rubio, Rand. We could go back to Dole. You could go back to Cheney. So there's a certain deliberative democracy requires, it seems to me, a very, very strong deliberative branch and a commitment to a deliberative branch. One of the bad signs about keeping the Democratic Republic is the urge of members of Congress to bolt and go to the administrative state. And the judiciary has followed suit. But you're quite right to mention the judiciary. I did not.
Do we have time for one more question? Anybody else have a question? We have a question over here.
Professor.
Yes, sir.
I think I need to speak loud enough here. The 17th Amendment, your view on that in relation to Madison's Republic?
I think that in terms of the unfolding of Madison's Republic in the creation stage, he wouldn't have a problem with the 17th Amendment. Because if you look at the Virginia Plan, the 17th Amendment is where the people run of the state legislature elect the Senate, right?
Yeah.
And a number of my conservative friends have suggested that federalism died with the adoption of that 17th Amendment. I'm fully aware of that. And that the progressive wanted it that way. My problem with my conservative friends on that one is that there's no conspiracy going on. You cannot get more constitutional than two-thirds of the House, two-thirds of the Senate, and three-quarters of the state legislatures passing an amendment. So here's a situation where the Senate, elected by state legislatures, is being asked to stop the state legislatures from doing the election. And the three-quarters of the state legislatures are being asked to give up their power, and they do so constitutionally. So on one level, I don't think Madison would have a problem if it's done constitutionally. The second reason why I don't think it's going to be a problem is that I don't think Madison was not an advocate in Act One and Act Two for the presence of the state legislatures doing the electing of the Senate. It was to be elected in a different way. But to my friends, see the death and become pessimistic ever thereafter about the future of the Republic, I remind them that the 17th Amendment does not alter the key thing that Roger Sherman wanted, which was equal representation in the Senate. It's not how the senators get there as much as it is the representation of the states equally. But the 17th Amendment doesn't touch that. And in fact, in the amendment provision, as amended the Constitution, it is virtually the only way that a state can be deprived of its equal representation in the Senate is with its own consent. So I think my conservative friends have spent too much time bemoaning the impact of the 17th Amendment on federalism without recognizing that the 17th Amendment does nothing to alter equal representation.
Excellent. Well, please join me in thanking Dr. Gordon Lloyd.